Okay, that's fine.
Good morning.
Morning.
Say welcome. Seen something out there, little raindrops falling, which I'm thankful for because my grass needs to be watered and I don't want to do it, so. But we thank the Lord for his watch care over us always, his provision for us, and such a blessing in our lives. And I need to make one announcement before I step to prayer with you and we begin our time of worship. And that is, there's no youth worship this morning. There will be children's church, but no youth worship. He's out of town for the quiz team, and so be praying for the quizzers as they're traveling and those sorts of things. So let's have a word of prayer. Father, we come before you today and we just praise you, Lord, because you love us so much. And now bless in the service, bless in our time of worship, and our prayer, and our offering, and the word of God, and just be glorified. And Father, thank you for your Holy Spirit's presence and power, that you're with us always. Lord, we pray your hedge of protection around all those traveling with the quiz teams this morning and heading out to the convention, that you would bless them, strengthen them, and encourage them, and just anoint the time they share together, and just keep them safe in the palm of your hand. Then, Lord, be with each one who's on our prayer list, Lord, those recovering from illness, we give them to you and pray for your healing and your grace, Lord. You love us and you watch over us, and we know that you touch our bodies in times of sickness. And Lord, you also have the ultimate plan for our lives, whether it be to be in your presence or be here in this world and sharing our faith, Father, be glorified. And so, Lord, we just thank you. Be glorified now in this time. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning to you all. Quite a few on vacation. I know the Mullins are as well. So trust you'll enjoy just singing the Lord's praises this morning. I'd like to have you turn to number 505 in your hymn books. And start off the service singing Love, Lift Your Name. Think about the fact of the word prior to our salvation and what the Lord has done for us.
Oh,
the nursery. And if you go to look for Evelyn, she's either in the nursery or in the kitchen. But anyway, that's part of the ministry that we do here. So today I want to welcome you. And just grateful to see so many smiling and friendly faces. And I don't know if we have any visitors, but in case we do, and also for the rest of us, in your bulletin, as many of you have looked, there is this little thing that does tear out. And one side is that if you are a visitor, fill it out. On the other side is the place to write down your prayer requests. And we'll also have prayer requests in the center of the bulletin. And so that you can follow those. Evelyn and I have been coming here for, I think, 12 years now. I've been coming a little bit longer than she has, because I moved up here. And she was passed down in Indiana, preparing the house to be sold. And we finally got it sold, and then we were living with somebody else until we actually found a home, and then we cleaned it up and put some carpeting in there, and then we moved in. But we've been coming for 12 years, and I started in May, and I think she started in August. But anyway, what I wanted to do is to read a portion of Scripture. The portion I've selected is Romans 5. Actually, I was looking at the first 11 verses, but I'm not going to read the first 11. I'm going to read from 6 through 11. And they said, you know, what was meaningful for me when I came to read this? Well, the first time that it really took heart in me, I used 1974 in the fall as my salvation experience. And we started going to a Bible-believing church in the fall of 1975. And then we were accepted into membership on a Sunday evening service. And I'm sure many people here remember Sunday evening services. And then all of a sudden I looked at this and I shared it with my wife. And I looked at the, I'm going to start reading in verse 6, but there are four words in there that kind of describe either what I was or what I was currently struggling with. And I will point these out to you as I read them, but they made a very strong impact on me as a new believer. And since then, there are many passages in Scripture that also have But I'll start with verse 6, and I will highlight the words as we go along. It says, for while we were still helpless, that's number one, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly, that's number two. For one will hardly die for a righteous man, though perhaps for a good man someone would dare to die. But God demonstrated his own love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, that's number three, Christ died for us. Much more than having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath of God through him. For if while we were enemies, number four, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, much more having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And not only this, but we also exalt in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received the reconciliation. And that just really hit home to me so much back then. And I'm in the process of reading through the Bible again. And I will get into Romans probably in a couple more weeks. I finished the Old Testament thing. And it's interesting that if you just to go ahead and do it and read your footnotes and all that. Let's see if I'm forgetting anything. But anyway, I'm going to read a prayer. Usually I don't like to read prayers. But this one really stuck out to me. I've been reading several books on spiritual warfare. And I know that Andy's going to be starting a series in Sunday school next Sunday, and I selected this before I knew he was going to be doing that, and maybe this will be a lead into it. And I've been reading several books on spiritual warfare, and what they do is they give you a daily prayer. They have what's called the Freedom Steps, and there is a daily prayer that you can start off with. And so I'll go ahead and read that now. It says, "Dear Him," and I'm giving this in the first person. This is from me, but you can also follow along and kind of personalize it for yourself, where I say I, you think me, you know, or you say I for yourself. "Dear Heavenly Father, I honor you as my sovereign Lord. I acknowledge that you are always present with me. You are the only all-powerful and only wise God. You are kind and loving in all your ways. I love you and I thank you that I am united with Christ and spiritually alive in him. I choose not to love the world and I crucify the flesh and all its passions. I thank you for the life that I now have in Christ, and I ask you to fill me with your Holy Spirit so that I may live my life free from sin. I declare my dependence on you. And I take my stand against Satan and all his lying ways. I choose to believe the truth, and I refuse to be discouraged. You are the God of all hope, and I am confident that you will meet my needs as I seek to live according to your word. I express with confidence that I can live a responsible life through Christ who strengthens me. I now take my stand against Satan and command him and all his evil spirits to depart from me. I put on the whole armor of God. I submit my body as a living sacrifice and renew my mind in the living word of God in order that I may prove that the will of God is good, acceptable, and perfect. I ask these things in the precious name of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen." When going through the freedom steps that are in here, I see every book that Neil Anderson, he always puts the freedom steps in there, and I do recommend, and I try and pray them, if not daily, often. And with that, I thank you, and just pray that we will be blessed today with John's message and the rest of our singing.
Okay, next, a couple of songs that we're going to be singing kind of have the same idea, focusing quite a bit on heaven this morning. But in each one, I felt there's just a lot of additional things to think about when we talk about going to heaven and the aspects of it. So let's stand again and sing "Mansion Over the Hill."
Thank you.
Hey, that's great, Joey. Yeah. Father, we thank you so much for all your blessings. We are yet to be a blessing to people. We thank you for our salvation and trust that even everyone knows you as their Savior that's here. Or don't, they might even come and know you this morning. Thank you that we can get back into you our tithes and offerings as you have blessed us. And just thank you for the ministry of this church. Pray that you just continue to use it for your glory. Down in finances presently, but that would be something that we'll just see to help kind of bring about to get back on in where we need to be. And so we just commit ourselves today and thank you, Lord, for your blessings in Jesus' name. Faith is the victory. you couldn't sing that from the heart this morning, I trust that you can get this morning, though he sent that message, which will say, you may be seated.
I want to invite you to take your Bibles, and if you don't have one, there is one in the pew in front of you. Turn to Revelation chapter 7. Easy to find Revelation. You just start at the back and you turn towards the front, and you'll find it. They threatened with some stormy weather this last week. In fact, I don't know, have you ever been, how long it's been since you've been in a place where the power is out? My two daughters that live in Michigan this last week called me, and they said that their power went out Monday. They had a storm that swept through and knocked down a bunch of trees and just literally wiped out the power. And you know, Monday night, all through the night, they were in darkness. And I don't know if you've ever been in a state where it's just dark, you know, where you don't have any lights, where the street lights aren't on and all of that. You know, things just get so dark. And when we're in Revelation chapter 6, things on the earth are pretty dark. There's not a lot of good news, because the Lord is unfolding. He's breaking the seven seals that are in the seven sealed book that we saw in Revelation 5 and we've seen in heaven. So he's breaking them, and each time he breaks them, there are judgments coming forth on the earth. And so when we left in chapter 6, there was one of the judgments that took place. It says there, and I looked when he broke the sixth seal, that there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth and made of hair, and the whole moon became like blood, and the stars of the sky fell to the earth as fig trees cast their unripe figs when shaken by a great wind. And so you realize what was going on there. And then you continue on in verse 16, and those that, it says in verse 15, actually, the commanders of the rich and the strong and every slave and every free man, they hid themselves in the caves and among the rocks of the mountains, and they said to the mountains and to the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the presence of him who sits on the throne and from the Lamb, and for the great day of their wrath has come. And they ask a question, who is able to stand? Well, we're going to be answering that when we get to Revelation 7 today, because we're going to go from darkness, and we're going to leave the darkness of the earth, and we're going to approach the throne room of heaven once again, because John is once again drawn away from the earthly perspective and all the battle and all of the judgments that are going on, and now he's taken up into glory once again from the heavenly perspective, and he's seeing in the presence of God some great scenes. And I look at, we're going from darkness to light, and then we'll go back into the dark judgments once again. Let's pray today. Father, speak to our hearts as we approach the scripture. It's powerful. It has truth for us, Lord, that we just simply don't want to miss. We sang songs about salvation. I pray that no one here today is without having put their faith in Jesus Christ, the one who died for sins and was buried and rose again from the dead, because what we're reading about is just so marvelous, Lord. It's marvelous to be part of your family. It's marvelous to know that we're looking for Christ and his return, and excited about that. And so, Lord, meet us today as we read these scriptures, as we study, as we open the book, as we learn, as we grow, as we deepen our faith. Father, teach us. And then, Lord, as we're here, if there are those who are struggling in areas of, whether it be areas of dedication to you, or even moral purity, or deceit, or lying, or deception, or just struggling with depression, or lacking joy and not realizing how you can help them in life, Lord, speak to them. And Father, be with each one who is on our list, various ones that are in and out of hospital and care, Lord. Just touch them and raise them up. So now, Lord, as we're in this place, meet with us and feed us from your word. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So today we're turning the page from the darkness of the world and the question that was asked, who is able to stand? And we turn our attention into Revelation chapter 7. By the way, on a yellow insert in your bulletin, it looks like this. There is our sermon notes for today's message. And so I want to encourage you to take that and follow along with the message, because it makes it easier for you to just understand the scriptures, and it's there for you that you can jot little notes and remind yourself. Let's begin reading now in Revelation 7. It says, after this, I saw four angels standing. I saw
four angels standing at the four corners of the earth, holding back the four winds of earth, so that no wind would blow on earth or on the sea or on any tree. And I saw another angel ascending from the rising of the sun, having the seal of the living God. And he cried out with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was granted to harm the earth and the sea. And he said to them, "Do not harm the earth or the sea or the trees until we have sealed the bondservants of our God on their foreheads." And I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000, sealed from every tribe of the sons of Israel. From the tribe of Judah, 12,000 were sealed. And from the tribe of Reuben, 12,000. And from the tribe of Gad, 12,000. And from the tribe of Asher, 12,000. And from the tribe of Naphtali, 12,000. And from the tribe of Manasseh, 12,000. And from the tribe of Simeon, 12,000. And from the tribe of Levi, 12,000. And from the tribe of Issachar, 12,000. And from the tribe of Zebulun, 12,000. And from the tribe of Joseph, 12,000. And from the tribe of Benjamin, 12,000 were sealed. And after these things, I looked, and behold, a great multitude, which no one could count, from every nation and all the tribes of and peoples and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches that were in their hands. And they cry out with a loud voice, saying, "Salvation to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb, and all the angels standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures." And they fell on their faces before the throne, and they worshiped God, saying, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." And one of the angels answered and saying to me, "These who are clothed in the white robes, who are they? And where have they come from?" And I said to him, "My Lord, you know." And he said to me, "These are the ones who have come out of the great tribulation and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God, and they serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will spread his tabernacle over them, and they shall hunger no more, neither shall they thirst any more, neither shall the sun beat down on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb in the center of the throne shall be their shepherd, and shall guide them to springs of the water of life. And God shall wipe every tear from their eyes." You know, when you read these things, you realize that in the last statement in Revelation 6, verse 17, is this question: who is able to stand before God? The wrath of the Lamb, the Mighty One. And all of a sudden, you get into chapter 7, and really, in a sense, that question is now being answered, because there are those who are in the very presence of God. Now, we pick up with a scene, first of all, in Revelation 7, so we're going to start there together. Before we get into what we're going to be focusing on, we've talked about the seven seals. We are in this point in our diagram of the tribulation here, probably towards the middle point of the tribulation now. But there's like this little interlude between the sixth seal of Revelation 6 and the seventh seal of Revelation 8. There is this thing going on in heaven that God doesn't want John to miss. He says, "I need to show you something else before we break the seventh seal. Before we begin to break the other judgments, I need to show you something." And so it says here, after these, first of all, he's back and he's looking now, and he sees the four angels standing at the four corners of the earth. And he said they're holding back the fourth winds, which is really an interesting thing. And I didn't put a lot of the notes about this, but here's these four angels standing at the four corners, and probably north, south, east, and west. And scientists say that really the winds kind of originate from those points of our compass, that's how they start. And in fact, it's interesting when you read Revelation chapter 7, verse 1, because there are those who talk about that, the fact that the Bible makes these weird claims that the earth is flat, and they use Revelation 7, 1 as one of those verses, the four corners of the earth. And yet reading that, you understand that they're taking a little bit of poetic license, and they're talking about the fact that the winds are there, and the four corners, which is a scientific principle. They're not saying that the earth is not round, That's not the point of the passage. The point of the passage is God's sovereignty and his control over the elements of the earth. And it's, what's interesting here is here they are ready to bring the next judgment. They're at the four corners. God's about to pour out more wrath. But it says that another angel rises up and says, wait a minute, don't harm, and he literally says, don't harm the earth or the sea or the trees until we have sealed the bondservants of our God on their foreheads. Now, something is going to be happening in the midst of the tribulation here. God is going to be calling out his servants, and he's going to be marking his name literally on their forehead. Now, some of you have heard of the mark of the Antichrist, the mark of the beast. We'll be covering that a little bit later in the book of Revelation, where in order to buy or sell, you have to put the mark of the beast on the back of your hand or on your forehead. And so that's the mark of the evil one, the Antichrist. But God is going to have those whom he seals, and he puts their mark on their foreheads. We understand that from Revelation 14, and I'm not going to turn to it now, but you can turn on your own the first five verses. You'll learn a little bit more about that. But we learn here about a group of people. And as we're studying this together, Revelation 7, 1 through 8, talks about the great love of God for the people of Israel, because what we read here is that God has set apart for himself. It literally says, I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 of them from the 12 tribes of Israel. You know, God long ago said, I will never forget. And this is probably, I think, one of the most amazing passages in Scripture. When you're reading this, I mean, literally here, we are in the time of the tribulation, and people on earth have forsaken God. They have turned their back on God. They have refused salvation, so the rapture has taken the church out, and now we're in the midst of this time, and God is beginning to pour out his judgments on the earth, and yet suddenly, we realize that there are those whom God knows, literally by name, by ancestry, from all of the 12 tribes of Israel. This has got to be one of the most astounding principles in Scripture, that God never loses track of his people. No matter how much you forsake God, no matter how much you turn away from him, he knows you. In the midst of sinners, no matter where you are, at work or in school or in the wickedest den of people, God will never lose track of his people. What's true of Israel is true of you and I as part of his church. And I don't want you to miss this, because when you look, read Revelation, read all these things, and you think, okay, I know there's 12,000. What does that mean to me? Well, listen to this. Throughout all eternity, God still knows the 12 tribes of Israel. And he knows 12,000 of them from each of those 12 tribes. That's how much God knows detail about our lives. In fact, the Bible says he knows when a sparrow falls from the sky. He knows the very number of hairs on your forehead. He knows when you cry. He keeps your tears, the psalmist says, and even in a bottle. God knows all those details, so it's no big deal for him to say, okay, now this person here, I know that they have nothing to do. They haven't been to the synagogue for years, but that one's going to come to faith. And he's one of the tribe of Dan. And he knows 12,000 of them. It's literally an amazing thing that you're reading here in Scripture.
Amen.
And for you personally, you've got to think about it and say, God will never lose track. I don't care how bad my day at work is. God knows what I'm going through. I don't know how bad it is when someone comes against me and yells at me and forsakes me and turns and breaks a relationship or whatever it may be. I still know that God is in control. Because God knows what is going on. He will never forget me. None of us should ever forget that principle. If you go away from this study, just remember that God always knows where I am, who I am, and what I'm doing. If you need a reason to trust in God, just know that with God, you always have a friend. You always have one that, this is written, that he sticks closer than a brother. He knows your life, he loves you, he cares about you. So now let's continue on in our study, and let's just look at this a little bit. We understand a few things about 144,000. You know, salvation in the time of the tribulation, I want to talk about it a little bit, because one of the questions that is always asked is about salvation. Well, I want you to understand that God has 144,000 people from each of the 12 tribes. You can read all of the 12 tribes by name there. Now, this is interesting. 12,000 witnesses from each of the 12 tribes, 144,000.
Now, that's not just new math, that's old math too. It works both ways. Multiply 12 by 12 and you get 144. Well, about now. I like math. How many of you like math? I really love math when I know that God comes numbers. I think it's a marvelous thing. There's some things, unusual things, some notes you want to take about this. First of all, the fact that as we're studying this together, there's a difference in the names of the 12 tribes of Israel. In fact, it's kind of interesting, it's an interesting study. If you ever want to get into something, go through Scripture and just find all the places where the 12 tribes of Israel are listed and bring them up for yourselves, and you're going to learn some unusual things. One of the things I wanted to note here about specifically is that the names of Dan and Ephraim are omitted from this particular list. And the names of Joshua and Levi are substituted. Yet other times in Scripture, that's not the case. They're there and so on. And it's really interesting. In fact, I was reading one author, and so probably the best understanding I could find about this is that he says, in the Old Testament list, sometimes the order of birth is followed. Talking about the 12 tribes of Israel. Sometimes the order of birth is followed, Genesis 29. And at other times, it is the order of Jacob's blessing them, in Genesis 49. And sometimes it's the order of their encampment in the nation of Israel, Numbers 2. The order of the census before the invasion of Canaan is another numbering of the 12 tribes in the listing. The order of the blessing and cursing in Deuteronomy 27. The order of Moses' blessing in Deuteronomy 33. The order of the princes, Numbers 31. The order of the inheritance in Joshua chapter 13. And the order by the wives and concubines in 1 Chronicles chapter 2. And the gates of the city in Ezekiel 48. And all these different things. What's really interesting as you study this is you want to make a note here that in this particular case, Dan and Ephraim are omitted from the list. And so as you're reading that, you've got to say, okay, that's kind of unique. Why are they omitted? Well, the tribes of Dan and Ephraim were noted in Scripture as being guilty of idolatry. And we're not going to turn there today, but if you go back to Deuteronomy 29, you realize he said that literally he was going to wipe them out from the tribe because of their idolatry, because they turned from God. And so when you get to this portion of Scripture and in this particular list, they're omitted. Because this is about 12,000 people from each tribe that are considered by God for a special ministry in the tribulation period to be a testimony to others. And so God is calling them out in kind of a special way. I have another note here that the tribe of Dan and Ephraim were guilty and when they permitted Jeroboam to set up the golden calf to be worshipped. And the tribe of Dan was guilty in Bethel and the tribe of Ephraim also. So they were, Dan and Ephraim both were guilty of allowing worship. Dan at the set up the golden calves, and then Ephraim also in 1 Kings chapter 12. And so for this reason, these tribes were probably omitted here. However, the tribe of Dan and the tribe of Ephraim are listed later in the book of Revelation amongst the 12 tribes. In other words, this was for a special time and a special blessing on the people of Israel to name these tribes because they are now going to be used by God. Now, if you want to do something, I mentioned Revelation chapter 14. Just flip ahead there in your Bible if you want to see something else about these tribes. Something very interesting about the 12 tribes. Revelation 14 verse 1 says, "And I looked and behold, the Lamb was standing on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000. Having his name and the name of his Father written on their foreheads. And I heard a voice from heaven like the sound of many waters and like the sound of a loud thunder. And the voice which I heard was like the sound of the harpist playing on their harps. And these, the 144,000, now sing a new song before the throne and before the four living creatures and the elders. And no one could learn the song except the 144,000 who had been purchased from the earth. These are the ones who have not been defiled with women, for they have kept themselves chaste or pure." In other words, all of the temptations that are going on earth that they're living through with all of the immorality of Satan, that he's in control and he's doing everything he can, destroying marriage, destroying everything that's going on earth. And it says, these have literally kept themselves chaste, have not defiled themselves with other women. In other words, they're likely men who have never, either is that they are
virgin men, 12,000 of them from each tribe, 144,000, who are now dedicated themselves because of what God has done in their life, and they're going out now serving, and basically there are 144,000 witnesses of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And either that's the case, or it's just that it's a statement about testimony of who they are personally, that they keep their vows, they are pure in their marriage, and they never will defile themselves as everyone else in the world is doing. It's hard to determine, but these are the ones who follow the Lamb that says, wherever he goes, these have been purchased from among men as first fruits of God to the Lamb, and no lie was found in their mouth. They were blameless. So, as you're studying through the book of Revelation here, you realize that God has a secure plan in place, and he knows his people. 12,000 from every tribe of Israel, he's got them preserved, and he puts a mark on their forehead to know so that they cannot be harmed. And you'll see that as we come to other places where it says that you cannot hurt the ones who are sealed with the mark of God. And so you go on now, Revelation, the last type of Revelation is even something now you say, well, that's pretty crazy. But now you come to something that, to me, is even almost more astounding. Like I said, Revelation chapter 6 is like that. If you had a flashlight in a dark night, this would be it. Because you're reading about all these judgments in chapter 6, and then 7, and chapter 8 and 9 and following, all this darkness and all the problems that are going on earth. But here is this light, and you're seeing something here. Now, let's look. There's a salvation for God's people, but now there's a great multitude of people being saved. He says, after these things, in other words, he looks to a different spot in heaven, and he sees something else. He says, and I behold, there was a great multitude, a multitude that was so big that no one could count, from every nation and all the tribes and peoples and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, and palm branches were in their hands. He says, here's this other multitude of people. There's the witnesses for God sealed over here, but now here's another. And some are from Israel, some are from every nation and tribe, every place on the earth. And what's interesting is John says, I can't even count these. Now, as Andy pointed out to me earlier today, he loves the book of Revelation as much as I do. And as you get in there, you realize that John is able later to talk about armies of 200,000 people and all this. This is a multitude so big that he couldn't even number them. Or they weren't numbered for whatever reason. But people often ask, what happens in the tribulation? Can anyone ever be saved? Can they come to know the Lord? Well, the answer is here for you. There will be a great multitude of others who will be saved during the tribulation by literally being martyred. Now, we'll go into that as we get through the book. We'll talk about the system that the Antichrist puts up and what he does to people that, I mean, literally, we talked about the mark on the back of the hand and the forehead. That's one of the things that are going to happen, that if you don't have it, you can't buy food. And ultimately, it's going to be the cost of your life in order to be saved. In other words, you have to endure to the end. You can't give in. What's amazing is that there are so many people, a multitude of an innumerable amount, that will be saved during this time, even though it's a horrible time on earth. And even though to be saved, you are going to have to literally let your life be slain. In fact, we'll see later that what's going to happen is that people who want to be saved during the time, and ultimately the Antichrist will take off their heads. And even further than that, that there will probably be persecution, is that perhaps even, as Scripture tells us, that there will be children against parents and parents against children. In other words, he may even use them to have your children in front of you and say, either take my mark or we'll slay your children or something like that. That he will be so evil that he won't care. He just wants people to take his mark, to be sealed for his kingdom and not God's kingdom. Now, we see God's pattern of love in an amazing way. But in the time of the tribulation, there will be many people who accept God's love. And I want to look at that for a minute. Actually, let me pause for a moment. I didn't put this on the PowerPoint, but we'll take your notes with me for a minute. The question is there, how will people be saved during the tribulation? Well, we know one thing, that there's 144,000 sealed ones, and as you learn in the book of Revelation, these 144,000 are witnesses. In other words, they're going to be on the earth, they're going to be sealed. When the various plagues are coming, they won't be harmed by those plagues. They will be special missionaries for God, going throughout the earth, presenting the gospel to those who are lost. Then the second part of that, there are three things on your notes. Secondly, God will have two witnesses on the earth during the tribulation. Revelation chapter 11, we're going to get there in a few weeks. I'm trying to do a chapter a week, so just a few weeks away, we'll learn about the two witnesses that God has on the earth. These are going to be two, and I'll speculate on who they are at that time. I'll keep you baited for that. But as we get to Revelation chapter 11, you realize there's two of us who have the ability to do miracles and who can resist the Antichrist. And eventually they will be literally their lives will be taken, but then they will be brought back to life. They will be martyred and resurrected. And then there's also in Revelation chapter 14, the third thing is there's a gospel, there is an angel flying through the mid-heaven presenting and sharing the gospel, and how exactly that works, we're not really clear, other than the fact that the gospel is going to be magnified in such a way that people are going to be able to trust and accept the gospel of Christ. So there are those who will believe. People in the tribulation who choose to believe will be granted salvation from the eternal punishment of their sin. And I put this in your notes so that you have this for yourselves. But now let's take a look. I wanted to close the sermon with something on a little more positive side, and I wanted to note some things. When we see God's pattern of love for those who have rejected him, it is amazing that in the time of tribulation, how God accepts. And you can literally claim the same truths for yourselves. First of all, look at verse 10. It says, "And they cried out with a loud voice, saying, Salvation to our God who sits on the throne and to them." In other words, we understand that God has given to them. God shows his love by just giving them salvation. Now, remember, they didn't want anything to do with God in this life. They went through their lives and they missed the rapture of the church. They denied Jesus Christ, so when he came on earth and didn't go to church, didn't believe in him, or maybe they went to church and never made a decision for Christ, whatever happened, they never believed in Christ. And they missed the rapture, and now they find themselves in this time of tribulation, and they're scared, and they're wondering what is there in life for them, and they're frustrated. And then they hear the gospel, and they believe, and then finally they have to pay with their life. And what does God do? He rewards them, even though they turned away from him, even though they never believed on him. They wouldn't listen to the gospel. They didn't believe it was for them. It was for the other guy. I'll believe it later when it's my time. Now they had to pay a heavy price. But God still loves and forgives enough, just as he does with us. You see, every one of us are not worthy of salvation. All of us have sinned. Sometimes people look and say, well, they shouldn't. They missed the rapture. They shouldn't be allowed. And people can be that hard of heart. But that's not the case. I mean, God loves each one of us so much. And he loves you today with your here. And there is sin in your life. And you're practicing sin. You can forsake that sin. The Bible says that God will cleanse you. In fact, when you get to the next statement, verse 14, it says there, "And I saw him, and I said to him, My Lord, you know who these are. These are those who have come out of the great tribulation, and they have washed their robes." In other words, their lives have been cleansed in the presence of God. There is a cleansing that goes on. They have made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Remember what 1 John 1, 7 and 9 says? The blood of Jesus Christ does what? It cleanses us of what?
All
sins gone. And I keep saying this, I'll say this, and hopefully you'll remember this, but I like to picture it that God looks at us through rose-colored glasses, in other words, or blood-stained glasses. In other words, even though we are dirty and sin and our lives are ugly and we feel unworthy, when God looks at us, the filter of the blood of Christ takes all that away, and he sees us now pure and able to stand before him as if our lives were completely white, completely cleansed of sin. In fact, the Bible says he removes every sin. He says, if you confess your sins, God is faithful and just to forgive your sins. In other words, to remove them from you and to not require the guilt punishment for them anymore. He will wash them away. He will make you cleansed. He will make you whiter than snow. And so here are these ones who go into the tribulation and they lived a sinful life and they did their own thing and they wouldn't trust in Jesus Christ. Now they're in the tribulation. Now they're willing to believe in Christ. Now they're put to death and they're in heaven and God cleanses their life completely. He takes away their sin so much so that they are there able to stand in the throne room of God before him. It's an amazing thing how God, how much God loves us. These truths are the same truths in your life. God is willing to take away all of your sins. The third thing we learn about the verse 15, it says, and for this reason they are before the throne of God. And look what they do. They serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne shall spread his tabernacle over them. When we look at this, there is the complete acceptance by God. God welcomes them into his presence and he allows them and says, you know what? You're here, I've got something for you to do. And they minister to God. They're there in his throne and in his tabernacle, or actually in his presence at the throne room of God. And it says literally, he spreads his tabernacle over them. In other words, he just totally welcomes them. They're accepted. No matter how much they sinned while they were on earth, because they believed in Jesus Christ, and they endure to the end, they're brought into his presence and God accepts them. And I love that thought. Because I know my life and I know the ways I've failed Jesus Christ and I know the times I did things that weren't pleasing him. But I know that God completely accepts me as well. Do I deserve it? No. On my own standards, if I had the same standards as God had, I would reject me. But God says, no, I love you so much. God so loves the world that he gave his only begotten Son. That if anyone would believe in him, they will not perish, but they can have everlasting life. They will have it because God will give it to them, and God will take them. And they get spared the trials of the tribulation. But for those who go through it, we also learn something here in verse 16 and 17. It says, nor shall they ever hunger, or they shall hunger no more, neither shall they thirst any more, neither shall the sun be down on them, and nor any heat, for the Lamb is in the center of the throne, and he will be their shepherd. Now, you realize what God does, he provides for them. These are the things in the tribulation. They didn't have any food. They didn't have shelter because they were being persecuted by the Antichrist. And now God is wiping all that from them, and he is providing for them. He's welcoming them into his presence, and they shall never thirst anymore. The sun won't be down on them, and all of the trials of the tribulation and the heat and the pouring out, now they're not feeling that wrath anymore. For the Lamb in the center of the throne shall be their shepherd and will guide them to the springs of the water of life. And then finally we learn about comfort. That God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. You know, once again, I know we always have this idea that, you know, there'll be no more crying there and all those things are going sleeping. But realistically, in heaven, we've seen two times now in Revelation that there is crying there. There are tears and God's waiting to wipe them away. And they're mourning over what they had been through, and God is calming them and comforting them. So now they see that there's no more suffering. They see God's eternal plan. They understand and comprehend it. Now, two things I want to close with today. First of all, the people of the tribulation who choose not to believe, we're going to see what's going to happen now in Revelation 8. It doesn't end here. It kill goes on, and now you begin to open the seventh seal, and that begins the next form of judgments that you're going to witness in God's book. But God always tells, you know, he warns. He, in a loving way, he gives his grace. I want to share something with you at the end because I didn't want this to be negative. There's a seed to grow by here. You see, the reality is that God never fails or forgets, nor does he ever abandon his people. I want you to remember, I always go back to the scripture and I remind people of this. Because of where we live and the society we're in. Turn to Hebrews chapter 13, verses 5 and 6. I love these verses. And I still cannot remember how Brother Larry and Gene taught me to do the little thingy with these verses. There's a hand movement from Good News Club or CEF with these, and I always forget what it is. But listen to this. Let your character be free from the love of money. In other words, you struggle with your finances, let that be set aside. Be content with what you have, because he said to you, I will never leave you, nor will I ever forsake you. I will never do that. God never forgets his people. We see that in the book of Revelation to the nth degree, because he knows everyone from the tribe of Israel and then all this multitude. He's never going to lose track of them on the earth. God never forgets his people. And there's a promise to us today. He will never forget you. If you're struggling with money, you know, just realize that you need to learn to be content and not overspend, not do the things that you've got you in the problem, but trust him, because he says, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you. But listen to this. He says, so that you and I can confidently say this, the Lord is my helper. That should be our testimony. Say it with me. The Lord is my helper. Now say this, I will not be afraid. I will not be afraid. And now this, what shall man do to me? Ever thought about that? Relationally, see how God grows. You can just sit there and say, you know what? All this trouble that's coming on the earth, God knows me. And I can say, the Lord is my helper. I won't be afraid. What can man do to me? What's it going to do? Take my life? It takes my life, I go to glory.
Amen.
And then I'm with Christ for eternity, and there's no more suffering, there's no more pain, and all the needs of my life are met. I mean, all of this is there, and it's true. It's there for you. What promise we have. That's why I want to end this with this great, great promise. The Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What shall man do to me? But if you're here today and you're struggling, let me just say one more thing. Call on him with your needs. Another portion of scripture in Hebrews, it says, since then we have, for Hebrews 4, 14 to 16, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast the confession of our faith. In other words, it says, Jesus came through the heavens, he endured it all, he came to earth for us, and now he's there for us. He says, we do not have a high priest, that is, one who ministers for us. He says, we do not have one who cannot understand or sympathize or identify with our weaknesses. But we have one who has been tempted in all things like as we are, and yet he is without sin. So let us boldly come to this thing called the throne of grace. We can go before his throne in prayer. Let us boldly come to his throne so that we can receive mercy and find grace to help us in our times of need. See, when you're in this book of Revelation, you realize that God has made you promises. God has a plan, and he's going to pour out his wrath on those who turn away from Christ. And God will keep giving them the opportunity to be saved, and many will take that opportunity. Right now, you're in a different time period. You're in what we call the church age, and God's grace is extended to you, and his Holy Spirit is there for you to live, and you can prepare yourself. The Bible says that someday our role in Scripture is going to be testified to by the people in this life, whether it be gold, silver, precious stone, the good things that we do, or whether it be wood, hay, or stubble. God's going to look at our lives and he will judge. Are you ready to meet him today? You know, if the rapture took place today and you've been lifted out of here as a believer and you stood in the very presence of God, how would you feel? Would you be embarrassed? Oh, I was going to change this in my life and I never did it. I never forsook that sin. I wish I had, and now I'm in the presence of God and now he's going to judge. You know, all those things are what you stand before him and say, Lord, I'm ready. I'm ready to meet you face to face. I put aside the trivial things of earth, and I'm okay with that, Lord. You can take me right now. Close your eyes for a minute and bow your heads. Just go before the Lord in his presence. I reminded you of a great scripture before, Romans or 1 John 1:9, that if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just. Would you just take that moment right now? Because the rapture could happen by the time I finish this prayer, or by the time I give the announcements, or by the time I give the benediction. And if it does, you're going to be looking face to face in the eyes of Jesus Christ. Are you going to stand there having asked for forgiveness for the sins of your life, or are you going to stand there saying, oh, I wish I had repented? You know, there's something in Scripture that we do that's called discipleship. We grow in the Word of God. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God. It's profitable for teaching, for correction, for reproof, for the training in righteousness, and it's there for you to grow in faith. Study the Word of God and to understand. If you're here today and say, I keep getting caught in these habits of sin and I need help, Just contact me. I'm willing to give you help. We have booklets here that can help you grow and be discipled in the faith. We want you to. Say, Lord, cleanse me of my sin. Wash me and I shall be pure. Make me whiter than snow. And I thank you, Lord. prayers of your people. Lord, make us fit and ready for the kingdom of God. Help us to be your witnesses, that we would share your love and grace with others. We pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Well, I want to share with you some of the things that we have here ahead of us by way of announcement. There are some things planning. I want to mention that, you know, in July 17th, we'll have a missionary guest with us that morning. Brother Dave Stockman going to be in town, so he's coming and going to share the word of God that morning. Those of you who know Brother Dave, I love to listen to him preach. Glory.
Amen.
And I can't say it the way he does, but it'll be a special Sunday here, so look forward to that. There'll be more details coming in the bulletin. I need to say something else. Buford and Sheila Mullins are on vacation, so I can say this now, and hopefully, you might want to cut that again.